Hello and welcome to the video review of the Rodan & Swartz FPC Z10 Educational Kit. So that is this unit that I got right over here, a RF teaching kit. So why did I get this unit? Well, I have some knowledge of electronics, but I don't consider myself to be an RF expert. But I'm eager to learn a little bit about this, what always feels a bit like black magic. So I thought buying this kit will be a great opportunity during pandemic times to do so. Now, the interesting thing is that one can hardly find any information about this particular board. On the internet, there are no reviews, there are hardly any discussions. I merely found a couple of people which are asking whether other people have any experience using it. So I thought this would be a nice opportunity to do a video review of this board myself. Now, first I would like to introduce what this board really is, talk a little bit about its functional blocks, and inspect the unit a little bit more close. Then we'll return here back to the bench and I'll do some experiments and we'll go and measure it with the oscilloscope and the spectrum analyzer here. And then finally, I will share my thoughts, draw some conclusions, and try to answer the question whether this board is really worth buying. And I can already tell you that are some really nice things to be said about this teaching board. At the same time, there are some areas in which I think Rodan and Swartz really still have to up their game. But fortunately, these are areas that can relatively easily be fixed. But first, let's go and see what this unit really is. Now, what are we actually talking about here? This is a radio frequency test kit that is advertised as a teaching solution for university demonstrations, particularly together with Rodan and Swartz FPC 1500 spectrum analyzer. And we'll actually be doing some experiments using that spectrum analyzer later on in this video. So what does the kit itself has? It has a full transmission and receiving circuit. It's a super heterodyne circuit, so it has an intermediate frequency of 200 MHz and a RF frequency of 836.5 MHz. It got a built-in PLL synthesizer. It got interestingly, an IQ modulator and demodulator. And it also got a selectable linear and switched power supply for the synthesizer, which you can use for some EMI troubleshooting. How does the power supply quality affects the signals of the unit. And so this unit is selling for a price of approximately 500 euros, $625, although you may qualify for educational discount if you buy this. Now, this is how the unit looks from closer by, and you can already see on the silver screen there's a block diagram, and actually we find a block diagram in the user guide. Now, I must say I'm not particularly happy with the block diagram in the user guide. We see some very strange errors, which are clearly wrong. We got a number of ports that have the same number, the same identification. And for this review, I think it's better to look at a simplified block diagram, which is the one that I'm presenting here. And I would like with you quickly to walk through this block diagram and to see what are the main functional units in this board. So first of all, here we have the IQ modulator. And the IQ modulator, basically, IQ signals are so-called in-phase signals, I and quadrature, the Q signals. So these are two sine waves that have the same frequency, but are 90 degrees out of phase. And when we amplitude modulate these two sine waves, we can do so each with our own input signals, coding two input signals at once. And the resulting signal then has an amplitude variation, but also phase shifts. And interestingly, the intrinsic signals, the input signals of a IQ modulator can be both positive and negative, so different from regular AM modulation. And the result of this is that the phase shifts can be all the way up to 360 degrees, so basically all the way around. Now, of course, you can find much more information on IQ signals and quadrature modulation in the literature, and I can particularly recommend the book you see here at the bottom of the screen. Now, the particular chip that is used in the kit that we're looking at today is one from Analog Devices, which is one that can directly generate a baseband signal on the basis of two inputs of between 140 MHz and 1 GHz. And in this kit is used to generate a 200 MHz signal. Now this analog devices chip is used for applications such as GSM and 3G and wireless LAN. Now next in the block diagram we find a balanced mixer. And it receives the signal from the IQ modulator, of course, and the signal from a frequency synthesizer. And the frequency synthesizer generates here a signal of 636.5 MHz. So the resulting radio frequency signal there is 836.5 MHz. We can also have the frequency synthesizer generating other frequencies, but I'm not going to talk about that today. And that same frequency synthesizer is, by the way, also used basically to generate clock signals for the IQ modulator in the kit. Now, then we have a bandpass filter, and that is tuned to the RF frequency of this kit, 836.5, and has a bandwidth of 20 MHz. We got a programmable attenuator that can be programmed in 64 steps of 0.5 dB each. So you can attenuate from 0.5 all the way to 0.32 decibels. And finally, we got a low noise amplifier, has a gain of 9 dB, a noise figure of 2.6, and the device used here is an Infineon BGA616. So that is a driver amplifier that's also used a lot for GSM and 3G and wireless LAN and that type of devices. It's a cascadable 50 ohms block amplifier, and it can amplify basically from DC all the way up to 2.7 GHz within 3 dB. That are the specs of that unit. Now we've seen all the transmission circuit and the receiving circuit is pretty much the same. It has the same functional units, only in a different order. We start again with an attenuator. Then we have the same amplifier. We have the bandpass filter. Again, we have the mixer, which is basically fed from the same frequency analyzer. And we got the IQ demodulator. And the IQ demodulator, like the modulator, is a device from Analog Devices. And again, a unit that's often used in GSM, 3G, wireless LAN type of applications. Now we've basically seen like the whole block diagram. These are only the most important parts. There are actually more parts of the unit. Some I'm going to talk about in this review, some now not. So let's inspect the actual unit a little bit closer. And so the top view looks like this. You might be like, wait, there's a lot of connectors here. And previously I was only talking about two input, two RF in and out, and two basement output signals. What are all the other connectors? Now, well, that's one of the nice thing of this kit basically is that each of the elements can be used separately. So there are switches, actually there are electronic switches in the circuitry that you can basically set using a small header, and that allows you to use each unit independently. So you can sidechain them or use them for other projects separately. This is very nicely done. And on top of it, we also get some ports for calibration of a vector network analyzer. So we have a port that can serve either as open or short, and a port that can serve as a load of 50 ohm. So this way you could calibrate basically your vector network analyzer in the same way when you're later going to measure ports basically from this kit itself. So that's a nice additional peek here. Now this is the bottom view of the device once you remove the case. There's a metal case at the bottom of it. There we find some more of the electronics. And if we zoom in a little bit more, we see here, for example, on the top right, we see the modulator part. On the left bottom, we see the Amtel SEM microcontroller, and that one basically controls the synthesizer and the phase locked loop circuitry in the device. Everything looks really neatly laid out. I mean, it's a very good looking design here. So welcome back at the lab, and now we're actually going to measure the teaching kit a bit. And while doing so, we'll also get to know something a bit about the measurement instruments that we're using. We're going to use a signal generator to create some input signal for the unit. We're going to use a Rohde & Schwarz RTB series oscilloscope to inspect the input signal, but also the demodulated output signal of the unit again. And we're going to use a Rodin & Swart FPC series spectrum analyzer to inspect some of the high frequency signals that we're going to be interested in. So what were our measurements going to be? Now, first of all, we're going to look a little bit how the unit behaves if we connect an input signal to it. We're going to inspect the intermediate frequency modulator signal, so the IF signal. And then we're going to see the RF signal coming out of the unit. And after that, we're going to turn on the receiver side of the teaching kit as well. We're going to look at the demodulated signal, and we're going to see how that demodulated signal compares to the input signal. So here we go. In terms of the input signal, all that we know from the manual is that it supports an input signal of 1 volt peak. We don't have any other specifications, so we'll just find out while we go. So we got two inputs, the I input and the Q input. The Q input I'm going to short for a second because we're not going to use it for the start. This is actually a shorting SMA plug that is used for VNA calibration. And we're going to connect the input in a second. Now, I prepared an input signal of 1 volt peak. We know that is allowed. We don't know anything about the frequencies it supports, so I created a 100 kilohertz sine signal here on the signal generator. And I'll just turn that signal on and we'll see it appearing on the oscilloscope. And at the bottom readings of the oscilloscope, indeed, see it's about 100 kilohertz and about 1 volt peak. And now we're going to connect this to the teaching kit. And look carefully on the oscilloscope screen. Yes, it halves in two. And now the oscilloscope basically is telling us that it's only 0.5 volt peak. So what can we conclude from this? That the input impedance of the teaching kit is actually 50 ohms, because I know the output impedance of the signal generator is always 50 ohms and the signal cuts in half. So now we know the input impedance of this unit. Actually, the signal generator got a special 50 ohms output mode that we could activate. But if you look more closely at that unit, actually that special output mode doesn't change anything about the signal coming out of it. It's always 50 ohms output impedance. The only thing that the special 50 ohms output mode does, it changes the readings on the screen, anticipating the load, so it would halve already the amplitude level in here. And one useful feature is also that you can also specify the values in dBm on your function generator. Of course, without knowing the load, that would be impossible, but if it's set to a 50 ohm load mode, then you can also do it in dBm. That's a useful function. Anyway, now we got the input connected and we're interested to learn, of course, about the first modulated signal that's coming out of that. And to do so, we're going to use the signal of the spectrum analyzer here. We know that the intermediate frequency is 200 hertz, so I'm going to put the spectrum analyzer at 200 hertz center frequency. We're going to look at a signal which is modulated with a 100k sine wave, so let's choose a span of 100 megahertz, so that would allow us to see everything. We're going to connect the spectrum analyzer to a signal. Today, for the first time, I'm going to use this new cable I got from Minicircuits. It's their ULC series measurement leads. And I must say I'm very satisfied with it. So I'm going to have some more of these. I got the input signal connected. And what we're also going to do here finally is change this little setting here, the little header here, because that allowsly makes the signal come out here instead of going through all the unit. Now we can already see on the spectrum analyzer we got some signal. It's already overloading, so I'm going to take a little bit care of that. Okay, we already see something happening. We'll need to reduce the resolution bandwidth in order to get a proper view of that signal. So I'm going to reduce it here to 300 hertz. Yeah, and we're seeing here a signal pretty much what we would expect to find. We find a carrier and we find two side lobes. Let's quickly check the frequency of the modulated signal we're getting. We'll use the marker for that. We'll activate the marker. He will go to the highest position, so I'll just make him force to go to the third highest position. Yeah, so the carrier frequency is about 200 megahertz, exactly as we expected. If we add another marker, we see one side lobe which is 100k above, And if we add another marker, we find the second side lob, which is 100k below. So that is the type of signal we would indeed be expecting here. Let's move the markers out of the way. We can also look at how this IF signal actually looks like if we would modulate it with something else than a sine wave. So let's give that a quick test, and let me move the span to a little bit wider value, like 2 MHz. So we're going to see a little bit more on the screen of the different side lobes that we might be getting. And in terms of other signals, we can start looking at some of the so-called window signals. So these are signals that pretty much look like a sine wave, but not precisely a sine wave. They have other distributional mathematical properties, and we're going to see that actually their side lobes are going to look different. So on my function generator, I'm going to go to waveforms, arbitrary waveforms, and I'm going to go to window functions. And right here we have the so-called Hamming function, and it looks quite a bit like the sine wave, but we see actually that the carrier frequency has a higher energy level. On the oscilloscope it looks pretty much like a sine wave, but it's not exactly the same. Let's move to the Hamming function. We see here that the energy of the carrier is changing. The so-called Kaiser window function. Now we see something different. Actually we see 6 side lobes now, in addition to the carrier wave itself. And we also see now on the oscilloscope that the signal looks slightly different than a sine wave. The Blackman function, that one has 4 side lobes apart from the center frequency. And we finally going to look at the triangle, which is not a Windows function really, it's a triangle function. We can see that on the oscilloscope. Yeah, then we see what we expect to find. We find many more tones basically around the carrier frequency, and if we increase the spam a little bit, we'll see that they actually go on much further. So let's take a 10 megahertz spam and let's see. Yeah, we see many tones now coming around here. And if we would actually, as a final experiment, take a square wave, we would basically expect that the tones that are further away from the carrier frequency have even more energy in them, and they go all over the spectrum. Let us do that right now. Square wave. Yeah, and exactly like we expect to see a square wave signal. So up to here, the unit really behaves precisely as we would expect a simple AM modulated signal. Now, you might also ask yourself, couldn't we be using just your oscilloscope to look at that? Oscilloscopes typically got a Fourier transfer function, FFT function, which should allow you to do the same type of things as this. So let us do a quick comparison here. We're just going to return to the sine wave first. I'm going to return here to the 1 MHz spam that we started off with. All right. And I'm going to connect the oscilloscope and try to see the same signal here. Okay, so now I've connected both the oscilloscope and the spectrum generator to the IF frequency output. So I didn't have a T connector for SMA, so I had to use a couple of additional BNC connectors here, but that's going to be all right. That is relatively low frequencies here. So let's go and take a look whether we can get the same type of signal visible on the oscilloscope. So I've connected here the signal to channel 4. We see the high frequency signal there. Let's move right away to FFT. Now, what frequency could we be looking at? This is a scope with a 200 megahertz channels. However, at 200 megahertz, it kind of shows more complex signal than just a sine wave. So the fundamental frequency the oscilloscope can pick up is considerably more than 200 megahertz. That's why it has a 2.5 gigasample per second sample rate. So in FFT operation, as you can see on the screen here, the oscilloscope actually can go all the way up to 600 megahertz. So we can at least see, or should be able to see, the 200 megahertz signal, including both of its side lobes. Now let's see how well it is doing so. So let's go to a center frequency of 200 megahertz, like on the spectrum generator. He's not behaving exactly the way that I expected it to. So let's do that slightly different. Yeah, let's say that it goes from okay, it's behaving a little bit different than I wanted it to. Let me see if I can put a spectrum at 200 in the center. Yeah, there we go. So we're looking now at the 200 megahertz center frequency. We want to reduce the span to see the signal. And what do we see? We cannot reduce the span to a value less than 5.7 megahertz. And this is the type of restriction you're typically going to see in oscilloscopes. You cannot select as little spam as you will be able to do in a good spectrum analyzer, where you could go to spam all the way down to much lower frequency and inspect your signals. Same thing for the resolution bandwidth. We're actually already at its lowest resolution bandwidth. We can't get any lower than this. So this is the signal, the best signal representation that we can find on the oscilloscope here. I mean, we can see the signal. I mean, we see the center frequency, we see two side lobes, but certainly does not allow the type of investigation as the spectrum analyzer does. So while FFT can be a useful function on an oscilloscope, I think it's really not a replacement for a proper spectrum analyzer if you're interested in HF signals. Okay, let's now also take a quick look how the radio frequency output of the kit looks like. And we could do that, of course, by connecting the outputs directly to the spectrum analyzer. But in this case, I will do it using an antenna connected to the kit and an antenna connected to the spectrum analyzer. So as for antennas, I'm going to use this little antenna over here, which is an antenna that actually came with with the LoRa kit for 868 frequency megahertz frequency. So I think that will serve as well for this unit here at 836. I already connected one here to the unit. And on the side of the spectrum analyzer, I'm going to use the an antenna. It's from Ariona. It's a German brand. The antenna is called the OmniLog 9200, and this is a omnidirectional antenna, as the name suggests, that works between 700 megahertz and 2.5 gigahertz. And it got detailed database of data sheets, so we know exactly how it behaves within that range. So this antenna, I'm going to connect it to the spectrum analyzer. We already see that it's picking up a bunch of different signals here in the air. So let's go and see if we can see the signal that is transmitted by our unit over here. So in terms of frequency, we should be somewhere close to 836 megahertz. So let's go there. Already see some things happening. In terms of span, let's take a 1 megahertz span to zoom into that signal. Yeah, so we're a little bit off in frequency. Let me add a little bit, 836.5, that's a bit more precise. Yeah, then we're in the middle. Again, we're going to change the resolution bandwidth. Yes, and here we have the RF signal that we would expect to find here. Right, so now let's also go and use the receiver function and look at how the demodulated signal looks like. So I got now two antennas connected to the transmitter and to the receiver, and I'm going to add the output cable, which is connected to the second channel on my oscilloscope. And now we're going to have some surprises in store. Because what happens if we connect it here? We get to see a sine wave. The sine wave is a bit of it's the opposite phase of the input. Actually, I found out that this just happens randomly with turning on the unit, that it might be in phase or out of phase. And the amplitude of the sine wave differs a little bit if I move my hand around the antennas here. But most importantly, we see here, this is not a very clean sine wave. There is clearly a interference signal here. And if we zoom in a little bit more, at least on the time scale, and let me also move to the second channel as a time base here. Yeah, that doesn't help a lot. But in any case, what we're seeing here is it's a complex signal. We got at least a number of different interference signal here that seem to be on top of our desired signal here. So let's take a quick inspection of what is actually going on here at these outputs.
Okay, I
now connected the spectrum analyzer to the regular output of the unit, so we can further look what's actually going on there in terms of tones coming out. And I also replaced the two antennas here with a direct loop wire, as you hopefully can see. Yeah, so that makes it a little bit easier for me, so it doesn't depend on my hands moving right now. Okay, so looking at the spectrum analyzer, I set it now at 100 kHz central frequency, and there we see the original tone. This is the tone as it goes into the unit, so that's what we expect to find. If we look a little bit further into the spectrum and say to 600 kHz, so we'll actually see a couple of higher harmonics of that frequency. If we very quickly take a look, we see the first one at 100 kHz, we see a second one at 200, and we see a third harmonic coming in. Oh, it doesn't exactly go where I want to go, I'll do it by hand. At about 400 kHz. But let's move on a little bit further into the spectrum, because this doesn't seem to be all the things that I'm seeing on top of the frequency, because I'm seeing some really high frequency signals coming on, so not just a second or a fourth harmonic. So let me put the spectrum analyzer and let's see until say 10 megahertz. And it's going to be a bit slow now because of resolution bandwidth, so let's turn it down a little bit. Okay, nothing here until 10 megahertz. So let's move it a little bit to 50 megahertz. Oh, and there we seem to see something. Look at that, we got something which comes in around here. Let's use the marker to find it. Somewhere around 36, so let's put that to the center of the screen. Let's decrease the span to 5 megahertz or so. Right, look at that, look at that. We're going to use the marker to put it a little bit more precise. megahertz. Okay, so now this should ring a bell, 36.5 megahertz. Because if we look at the specification of this device, the IF frequency was 200 megahertz and the RF frequency is 836.5. So the fact that we're seeing a 36.5 megahertz signal now in the output basically means we got some unwanted signal. So what possibly could be going on that out of the 200 megahertz IF frequency, the IF synthesizer actually got harmonics, and maybe the third harmonic, which will be 3 times 200 is 600 megahertz, if that one goes into the receiver side at the mixer and we mix that together with the incoming signal, then we might actually get the 36.5 megahertz here. There might also be other things going on here. We might also look at whether actually this 36.5 megahertz signal is modulated in some way. So if I put like a 1 kilohertz input signal, you can see it back. If that causes things, then there could be other non-linearities into the unit. But we're certainly seeing something. Does this mean I'm disappointed here? No, not really. I mean, this is the part that we're actually learning from. If everything would have been perfect, you know, there's not much fun in using a teaching kit and learning from it. And here we're actually seeing some phenomenon that we might want to dig into further. And one of the first steps I would probably like to take is to get a bandpass filter at 200 megahertz. And use that bandpass filter on the receiving circuit and see if that takes away the distortions that we see right now. But it will be a further experiment, because I will have to actually order that bandpass filter. I actually already looked up one for mini circuits again, and that looks like one that could be useful here. Okay, so now finally let's take a look at the IQ modulation, which I think is, you know, arguably the most interesting part about this unit. So let's see how it behaves if we connect two input signals to it. So what I did now is that I am connected two input signals. One is the signal that I already had before, 100 kHz, and in a moment I will add another signal of 200 kHz, so we can distinguish it from each other. And we're going to look at the output frequencies here. So on the oscilloscope, we can already see the first input, the I input, both the original signal and in green the output with a bit of noise on it. We already seen that before. And I will now add the second input with a frequency double as large. I'll activate it from the signal generator now. And what we see, yeah, as expected, we also got a second output signal, the Q signal, twice as high in frequency. Also here this noise, 36.5 megahertz noise and other noise tones that are part of this. We also see that the original signal get distorted a little bit as a function of the second signal coming in. So they do not seem to be totally orthogonal here. They seem to affect each other in one way or another. But it's still a little bit hard to see because of the noise that we're getting here. So how can we look at these signals a little bit more closely? Now, one of the ways we can do that is actually a new firmware functionality that was added to this RTB oscilloscope just 2 or 3 months ago or so by Rohde & Schwarz. I think it's very useful because in their mathematics function, you can now also choose to use a low-pass filter. So I will be setting a low-pass filter on the output of 200 kHz. On the other channel, I put a low-pass filter of 400 kHz because I'm using twice as high a frequency. I don't want to get that close to the 3 dB point. I'm going to activate these both and let me see here. Yeah, right. So we get them at the bottom of the screen. So we see, you know, fairly nice signals coming in here. So the bottom of the screen, M1 and M2, are actually the output, the demodulated output of the unit run through a low-pass filter. And I think they look quite nice. Now, if you do not have such a functionality like here as the low-pass filter on channels, the other way to deal with it basically would be not to use to show the regular samples on your scope, but use averaging, because the noise then will to a large degree average out, and then also the signal should be a little bit cleaner here. So let's go to averaging. Yeah, and also in that case, we actually get to see a little bit of a cleaner signal here. And so altogether, this looks great, and we actually get to see nicely the demodulated output on the unit. Finally, I also did a couple of experiments to see how it works, actually, if we put a little bit more complex signals into it. So we could go to multi-level signals on each of the input and see if we could use the I and the Q inputs independently, actually, to code like multiple bit values at the same time for each of the inputs as well as for within the inputs. Will take too much time if I do that all in this experiment, but I'll show you here one of the pictures that I got out of these experiments where we actually see a QAM type of modulation going on. That's certainly not coming out perfectly. I also got some better ones than this one, I think, but this is kind of illustrative to see that we do get all these signal levels out at the output, but in this case they don't look perfect yet, and decoding them would not be a straightforward thing yet. But it can be further improved, as I said, by playing around with the unit, trying to figure out how to reduce noise. So after having looked at all these experiments, what else is there to do? Well, plenty of things. One of the things that I would like to do from here is further investigate the source of the 36 megahertz interference signal that we earlier saw, and there are a number of different things to look at to figure out exactly what is going on there. I further want to measure the individual elements in the unit, so that is like S21 analysis, harmonic distortion, etc., their impact on the radio frequency chain. I would also like to do some experiments, perhaps with a separate receiver or decoder which has its own frequency synthesizer and PLL, see if we get that going. Experiment with several radio pass scenarios. One interesting route to go is to investigate the bit error rate. We can do that for a variety of different signals, including QAM. We could do that for a variety of bit rates, modulation parameters, radio frequency paths, etc. I mean, we could build a testing setup that use comparators at the input of the output of the in and outgoing signals, or ADCs. Could be a great Arduino project, for example. I also would like to explore the FM modulation. There's apparently a possibility to do FM modulation with this board as well. I'll come back to that in a second. And look at the impact of noise in the power supply circuit on the local oscillator. told you before, actually you have two power circuits there for the 3.3 volts basically that goes to the frequency synthesizer, and you can find out how that affects basically the quality of the signal, etc., etc. There are plenty of things still to do with this unit. Now, there's one thing I want to pay some particular attention to, and that is the user manual. And I must say I'm not particularly impressed there. Because what do we see in the user manual? First of all, we see plain errors. We see errors in the block diagram, in the numbering of ports. We even see a statement that says that the user should connect a 100 dBm source to a particular port. You really don't want to do that. You're not, even if you have that type of power at your disposal, you're not only going to blow away the whole board, you're going to blow away your whole lab. I mean, 100 dBm, that equals some 10 megawatts. So you really don't want to find this type of errors in a device that for educational purposes, teaching purposes. There are also ambiguities in the user manual, the user guide. Particularly, for example, about the way to power it with the two different USB ports. And actually, in practice, it seems to work different from what the manual says. And most importantly, I think the manual is rather incomplete. It says, for example, already on the first page, this user guide does not deal with the IQ modulator. Come on, that's a core part of this board. Why is it not dealt with at all in the manual? Then the manual also continues, there's an X300 switch used for frequency modulation operation, but this user guide does not deal with it, etc. So there's a lot of parts missing there. What's also missing, I think, is information on the input and output port. What I would like to see really for each of the port is the typical and maximum rating for voltage, power, frequency range, impedance, etc. Missing for most of the ports, basically. No information on the status lights that we find on the unit. And actually, I mean, I would really like to see a full schematics of this unit. I mean, we're not talking top secret here, but a full schematic would also help you to understand the unit. So what's my overall verdict of this unit? I really like it. It's a useful kit, I think, for people that want to explore the RF world. It's very flexible. I also showed you how you can basically sidechain and use all these different parts for your own project. It is very well built and well engineered. And I think the IQ part is particularly fascinating to experiment with. And there are also a number of nice test cases, specifically when you use RodeNSWORD's own spectrum analyzer, the FPC1500, where you can, for example, set the signal generator of that device at a fixed frequency and then actually start to do measurements. So you can generate basically your own frequencies that you feed into the mixer and go through a number of different scenarios there. The main thing that I really don't like about the unit is, as I said, is the manual. It's incomplete and inaccurate. And I think that's really work there to do for Roden and Swartz. Now, should you buy this unit? Well, that's really up to you. That's really what you want to do with it. How much you would find it worth. As I said, the regular price of this unit is about 500 euros or $725, although you might qualify for educational discounts. I'm not aware of many alternatives, basically, that offer kind of the same functionalities. The only devices that I'm aware of are actually the evaluation boards of analog devices for its IQ modulator and IQ demodulator, the same one as used in this kit. And you can get for those, you can get them on evaluation board. And a set of such evaluation board in itself, for a set you already pay 350 euros. And then you only got two parts of the many other parts that we find in the Roden and Swartz kit. So in that sense, I think it might be reasonably priced. But then again, it's up to you whether you find it worth to invest in such a unit. So that brings me to the end of this video. I hope you enjoyed it, and thanks for watching.